صلى الله عليك وعلى أهل بيتك المظلومين. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله الحسين. Peace be upon you, أو غريب أو شهيد أو مظلوم of Karbala. May Allah grant us in this dunya His ziyara, and in the next life His shafa'ah. Illuminate your hearts and majalis with a loud salawat for Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Respected brothers and sisters of the Singapore Jama'at, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In the previous nights, we spoke about the shaitan and the danger that he poses. And we went over some of the tactics that the shaitan uses to misguide us human beings. So we spoke about تطويل الأمل, when he excites false hopes. He convinces us to believe that we will live a long life, and thus we begin to delay our obligations towards Allah Azza wa Jal. And the other tactic that we spoke about was التزيين. التزيين is when he beautifies sins in our eyes, so that once we commit a sin, we think we're doing a good, noble act. So these are two important general tactics and methods that the shaitan uses to misguide us. And we said that the shaitan, he doesn't use the same method with everyone. No, because he studies us. Remember, we said he has uninterrupted access to us. So what does he do? He just sits, him and his minions, they sit and they just look. They search for our weak spots. They study us so they know where to strike us. What's my weak spot? So he will come from that angle. But there are some general common weak spots that most people have. There are some weak spots that almost every human being shares. And amongst those common weak spots that most human beings have is the love of money, the love of dunya, the greed that we have for this dunya, for property, for wealth, for stocks, the love of money. This is a common weak spot that we all have, almost every human being has. We differ on so many topics. We could rarely agree on anything. Social aspects, religious aspects, social, religious, and political topics, you'll find so many disagreements. But the one thing that the entire world agrees on is the love of money. We all love money. The Holy Quran mentions this. Allah says, وَتُحِبُّونَ الْمَالَ حُبًّا جَمَّا. And you are deeply in love with money. You love money so much. He makes this general call to all human beings. This is how we human beings are. We love money. In fact, this was the weak spot of Prophet Adam. Prophet Adam, we spoke about him the previous nights. His weak spot, because of this weak spot, he was taken outside of paradise and brought to this world, was because of greed. Yes, Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, he says, هَلَاكُ النَّاسِ فِي ثَلَاثْ وَالْحِرْصُ عَدُو. Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam says, وَالْحِرْصُ عَدُوُ النَّفْسِ. He says, greed, love of dunya, this is the adu, the enemy of the nafs. وَبِهِ أُخْرِجَ آدَمْ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ. And for it was Adam taken out. Because of it, he was taken out of paradise. Because he had greed. Shaitan, he fooled him that if you eat from this tree, that you will become immortal. You will become what? You will become an angel. His greed for that, it led him to eating from that tree. Even though we said this was not a sin, but it was something that Allah had asked him to stay away from. So the shaitan, he comes and he tries to exploit our greed. He knows we're greedy. He knows we love the dunya. He knows we love money. He tries to exploit that and use that against us to misguide us. You see, Al-Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says in a hadith, he says the shaitan, when he comes to misguide human beings, he has a list. He's given that list to all the other shayateen. Every possible method to misguide human beings is mentioned. It's mentioned in a specific sequence. You know, start with this desire. Start with this avenue. For example, start with envy. If that doesn't work, go to arrogance. If that doesn't work, try to misguide the human being through alcohol. If that doesn't work, through girls, for example. But the hadith says, when all else fails, when he goes through each one and it fails and it fails, he says, the Imam says, the shaitan is always reserving one last method, the most powerful method, which always, always works, or almost always works, unless you are one of those individuals that truly has taqwa that we spoke about, piety, like Imam Ali alayhi salam, like the story we mentioned with his brother Aqil, where he said no to this dunya, and he would not accept taking a penny, even if it was for his own brother. Or else, with most people, it what? With most people it works. What is it? The love of dunya, the desire for the money, for wealth. This is amongst the most powerful methods of the shaitan. In fact, the Imam, he says, when he arrives to this, he sits down, the Imam says, to love of dunya, love of money, he sits down and settles at this method so he can try it over and over again. Basically, what the Imam means by this is that it's a long-term strategy for the shaitan. He doesn't use it once, twice, three times. No, it's a long-term. He'll use it for 20 years, 30 years. You know why? Because the older we get, brothers and sisters, the greedier we become. Subhanallah. It's ironic. The human being has certain ironic behaviors. As we grow in age, two qualities also grow. This is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet says, "Yashibbu, yashibbu ibn Adam wa yashibbu fihi khislatan, al-hirs wa tul al-amal." He says the human being, as he grows, two qualities also grow in him. They intensify within him. What are they? Greed and hope, having hope in the dunya. He wants to live a long life. The older you get, the less hope you should have, because your life is you know, is shorter now. You have less to live, but he's more hopeful in the dunya. He wants more from them. And greed. The older I become, the Prophet says, your greed will also become greater as you age. You become more hopeful and greedy in the dunya. Well, as we said, it should be the opposite. I'm getting older. Why should I be more greedy? What am I going to do with all this money when I'm closer to my death, to my grave? But subhanAllah, this is how this dunya is. This is how the human being is. He grows and greed gets worse. When he's in his 20s, he's not as greedy when he is in his 30s. When he's in his 30s, he's not as greedy as when he's in his 40s, and so on and so forth. This dunya, as the Imams tell us, is like salt water. The more you drink, that won't quench your thirst. You'll become thirstier. You become more greedy. And that's why, subhanAllah, brothers and sisters, you find that we have billionaires today. Why are there billionaires? I mean, why didn't they settle at 100 million, 200 million? Even billionaires, their money keeps on increasing. You read the list of Forbes' richest individuals. Today, it's this person, you know, Jeff Bezos. The other day, it's the Tesla guy. The other day, it's... I mean, they reach 100 billion and they're still working. 150 billion, 200 billion. Why don't you retire? You have $200 billion. Subhanallah. Because this greed can never be quenched of the human being. When he has 200 billion, he says, I want 500. When he has 500, he wants to be a trillionaire. The human being never has enough of the dunya. Now, the shaitan knows this. He knows that our greed has no limit. And he comes and he tries to exploit us through this avenue, through our greed. He misguides us through the love of money. You see, there's a hadith that says, when money was invented, you know, we didn't always have money. Before money, the idea of money and gold and silver, it was people use the barter system. I give you milk, you give me bread. I give you, you know, tomatoes, you give me cucumbers. That's how it was. Barter system. And then a couple of thousand years ago, human beings, they invented gold and silver and currency. The hadith says that when the shaitan, now shaitan, he was there since Adam, before Adam. When the shaitan found out that human beings invented currency, he came, he got his hands on a piece of gold. A gold coin or a silver coin. He says he took that coin, the hadith says. He was so happy. He was thrilled. He hugged that coin. He kissed it. He said, Alhamdulillah, this is all I need for people to deviate, to misguide people, because people will kill for this. They will die for this. Where was this? Where were you hiding? I don't need people to worship idols anymore. No, people will worship the dunya. They will worship this money. Yes, brothers and sisters. So many people, they don't worship Allah Azza wa Jalla. They claim to worship Allah, but in reality, they worship the dunya. They worship money, as we said. Yes, they will do anything for money. It just depends how much you pay him. If you reach a certain price, she is willing to do anything. You know, it's narrated that Prophet Isa alayhi salam, he was with three of his companions one day. They came by a tree. The Prophet told him, Prophet Isa told the three companions, be careful, under this tree there is death. He said this and he left. He said, I'll go and come back. They went, they searched, they found gold. There was gold under that tree. So they said, why did Isa say that there is death under this? This is not death, this is life. They were so happy. There's three of them. So one of them, he said, let me go get food and come back. Once he went, the two that remained, they began to think, you know what? If we are two and the two of us share this gold, we will receive more. So they decided to kill the third one when he comes. Now, the third one, when he was out to get food, he was thinking, imagine if all that gold was for me rather than sharing it. Why don't I kill them, get rid of them, and it'll be all mine? So what did he do? He put poison in the food. He comes back, he gives them the food. They sit to eat. The two, they jump on him, they choke him, and they kill him. They say, now let's eat and celebrate because it's just between us. They eat the food, the poison kills them, they die. Isa comes back, he sees the gold is untouched and the three companions are dead. Isa used to resurrect the dead. We read that in the Quran, right? He would resurrect the dead. He resurrected them. And he told them, didn't I tell you that under this tree is death? You did not listen to me. You did not listen to me. You fought over the gold. You killed each other. You're all dead now and the gold is untouched. So this is how we are, brothers and sisters, sometimes. Sometimes we are willing to kill for money. So the shaitan, when he saw the currency, the gold, the silver, he was so thrilled and happy. And he said that this is all I need to destroy human beings, to misguide them, because they will do anything. So this is my new plan. And he told all his minions that the new plan is that we use money to misguide human beings. And now, alhamdulillah, we even have a new notion of money, and that is cryptocurrency. I can imagine how happier the shaitan is, because cryptocurrency, you know, the Bitcoin and the Dogecoin and the all these other cryptocurrencies, it's much easier to deal with it, especially for the new generation, than the currency, right? So I can imagine how happy the shaitan is now that he sees the human beings, they don't stop, you know, innovating, they don't stop impressing. Every couple of days they're inventing something new. So the shaitan probably, he sends to all of his minions, now the new deal, you know. And I was just reading one of the famous football players, you know who I'm talking about, Messi. Part of his deal with Paris was that he gets cryptocurrency, millions of dollars of cryptocurrency. So part of his new plan to his minions is we use cryptocurrency to misguide human beings. So you see, brothers and sisters, the shaitan, he uses money to misguide us. Now, the problem doesn't lie within money itself. Owning money is not bad. It's not evil. Money in itself isn't evil. Some people, they think that Islam is against owning money. You should live as a poor individual. No, brothers and sisters, owning money is not evil. In fact, you could use money for so many good causes, right? I mean, without money, how could we build masjids? How could we build imam bargas? How can we have these majalis? These majalis, they are costly, correct? So without money, we can't build hospitals. We can't build orphanages. Money is good. Nobody is saying that money in itself is evil. It's not evil. And in fact, you know, just to give you an example of how important money is, let me give you an example in the US. You see, money can help us advance Islamic causes. We Muslims, every country almost, we're behind, especially in the US. We're very behind here in the US. If you want to see how important money is in furthering and advancing Islamic causes, look no further than a man by the name of Sheldon Adelson. Go and Google him. Who's Sheldon Adelson? Sheldon Adelson, he died last year. He used to be a multi-billionaire. And at the same time, he's a staunch a staunch supporter of Israel. He's a Zionist multi-billionaire. And he was Donald Trump's number one donor. I read that he had donated $75 million to Donald Trump. This is all one man. He's a staunch Zionist. He's a multi-billionaire. He would give so much money. You know, if you remember a couple of years ago, the Trump administration, they moved the U.S. embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. I remember many Muslims, I heard them say, Trump, he proved to the world that he's a Zionist. No, brothers and sisters. Trump, I don't think, this is my opinion, I don't think that he's a staunch Zionist. Trump, brothers and sisters, he worships money. Whatever you pay him, he'll do it for you. If you can pay him enough, he'll do it what you want for you. Trump worships money. He did it for Sheldon Adelson. He did it to thank him for the $75 million. Because Sheldon Adelson doesn't give you free money. He gives you $75 million, but he has a request. The request of Sheldon Adelson was to move the embassy. And there was an article I read in the New York Times that said this, that don't think that the movement, moving the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, this was, you know, the belief or the ideology of Trump. No, this was internal politics. He just wants to thank, satisfy his donors. That's why all he cares about is money. You can buy Trump. If you are willing to pay enough, you can buy Trump. Give him money, he'll do whatever you want. And you know, and that's how Israel is so strong. How do you think Israel is so strong? The small country in the Middle East, it has the US, the superpower, at its fingertips. Because they spend. Because they have bought all the politicians. Look at the statistics. They give in every time there's an election in the US, whether it is in the presidential race, Congress, governors, mayors, whatever it is, they buy all those politicians. So that's why those politicians, they are always siding with Israel. They're all Zionists? No. It's because they love money. They can be bought, and they are bought. And I imagine, you know, if Trump would be paid $75 million, he wouldn't mind declaring Palestine, you know, as a state, because all he cares about is money. So money works wonders, brothers and sisters. Imagine if we had people like Sheldon Adelson, they were that dedicated, but to the Palestinian cause. You think we don't have wealthy Muslims, brothers and sisters? Wallahi, I know plenty of multi-millionaire Muslims living in the US, living in Canada, living, I'm sure you have, you know, in your community. So there are plenty of Muslim millionaires. But what do they lack? They lack the dedication. They lack the motivation. They have greed, brothers and sisters. They're not willing to give that money to cause to advance the agendas and the interests of Islam. Look at Sayyidah Khadija alayha salam. She had millions. She gave all of it fi sabilillah, all of it for Islam. So money in itself is not bad. In fact, we need money to make our religion stronger and to advance our interests. The problem, brothers and sisters, is when we start loving money, when we get attached to it. Ibn Abi Ya'fur is a companion of Imam al-Sadiq. He comes to Imam al-Sadiq one day and he tells him, I love the dunya, I love money, what do I do? So the Imam, he tells him, if you receive the dunya, if you receive money, what do you do with it? He tells him, I will get married, I will go to Hajj, I will give to my family members, I will give to people in need in the community, I will give sadaqah, I will give charity. You know what the Imam tells him? The Imam tells him, this is not love of dunya, this is love of akhirah. Because you're using that money to build your akhirah. So money is not evil. There's no such thing that, you know, there's a famous saying, money is the root of evil. No. Islam says, the love of money. When you are attached to money, you love it, this is when it becomes bad. This is when it becomes toxic. Or else you can spend money in so many halal ways, good ways, right? You spend it on your family, you put your kids in Islamic schools, you provide shelter for your family members. This is very good. There's nothing wrong with being wealthy if I want to do this. Yes, if I want to become wealthy just because I want to stack my cars, my Lamborghini next to the Ferrari next to, yes, I just want a huge mansion and just live life at its fullest. This in itself, this is waste. I'm wasting these resources. This is not necessarily, it's not haram, but it's not necessarily something good. But if I see money as a mean, not as an end, I use it to advance the agendas of Islam. There's nothing wrong with that, brothers and sisters. I use it to please Allah Azza wa Jalla, like the examples that we give. to advance the causes of Islam, the causes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put my children in Islamic school, spend on majalis, as we said. Majalis, they are costly, of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam, correct? And every time, every year we have a majalis, we have to go and ask the people, please donate, please give. So it's the lack of funds that restricts us. So having money, spending on Sabilillah, on Imam Hussein, on his majalis, this is something very good. Now, as we said, when we become attached to money, this is when it becomes a problem. This creates an opening for the shaitan. When he knows I love money, he says, I will go through the love of money and misguide that human being through his love of money. So he exploits our love of money. That's why, brothers and sisters, love of money is dangerous, because it creates an avenue for the shaitan against you, to misguide you, to fool you, to take you down, to destroy you. He makes you deviate through the love of money. And an Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, in a beautiful hadith, he explains how shaitan, how the devil, how he exploits our love of money to commit haram. Three ways. The Imam says the shaitan, in three ways, he exploits our love of money and misguides us. Three ways. Number one, the first way that he misguides us when we love money is that he leads us to make money from haram sources. I love money so much, even if I make it through haram, I don't care. Even if it's through immoral sources, I don't care. I'm in love with money. Money is an end. I'll do anything for it. This is when it becomes dangerous, brothers and sisters. Even if I hurt people, even if I destroy people's lives. Let me give you an example. There's a lot of examples of people who destroyed other people's lives, who trampled other people, just because they wanted to feed this desire, this greed within them. They wanted to feed it, yes? Even if it meant that what? That I kill people. Even if it means that I hurt people, I destroy people. It doesn't matter, because I want to satisfy this greed within me. There was a doctor a couple of years ago in the US. His name was Farid Fattah. You can Google him. He was a cancer doctor. Now, this man, his love of money and his greed led him to falsely diagnosing people with cancer so that he could make money off their treatment. So anybody that comes, he thinks he may have cancer, he just has a normal routine doctor checkup, he tells him, oh, you have cancer. Why? So that then he tells him, you need to take the treatment, and that treatment makes him money. He ended up, brothers and sisters, his greed led him to falsely diagnosing how many people? 553 patients, 553 victims. They had no cancer. He told them, you have cancer. He lied. And then he told them that you need to take the chemotherapy. And he made $34 million out of that, until he was finally exposed and he was arrested and put in prison. And you know, the chemotherapy, it takes years sometimes. If I know some people who have cancer, may Allah protect you from these sicknesses and diseases. Wallahi, it is terrible. It is terrible, those people that are taking chemotherapy. It's treatment, but in itself, chemotherapy is torture. Your teeth start falling off. You know, your hair, you start losing hair. It's painful. You start aging quickly. I've seen people who are taking chemotherapy, they start aging much quicker. Every month you age 10 months, you age 1 year. And I used to have an uncle, my great uncle, who was diagnosed with cancer, and he was taking chemotherapy. I remember there was a picture of my uncle before he took chemotherapy and after. Now, the real time was a year behind. So he was 74 in this, 75 in this. But when you see the pictures, you imagine, you think that in the second picture, he was 94. He was 20 years older. He had turned so frail, so old. This is what chemotherapy does to you. But this man, he did not care about that. He saw people just as vehicles to make money through. He saw them as cows so that he can milk. Complete disregard for human life. All these human beings, he destroyed their lives just so that he could feed that greed, until he was exposed. This doctor was exposed. Maybe there are many others who aren't exposed yet throughout the world. So this is what greed does to us, brothers and sisters. Many times you'll find some individuals, they are willing to destroy other people's lives just because he wants to feed his greed. And remember, we said greed has no ceiling. He was caught at 34 million. If he wasn't caught, maybe 70, 100, 150 million. Who knows? Look at some of the tyrants in the Middle East, brothers and sisters. I remember one of the crown princes of Saudi Arabia a couple of years ago, he died. I read in CNN that they estimated he left after him how much money? $270 billion. Allahu Akbar. 200, and this is the crown prince. You can imagine what the prince is doing, what the king himself is spending. And this is the dunya. We never get enough of it. So this is number one. This is the first way that the shaitan exploits our love of money, is that it leads us, that love, he whispers and tells us to make money out of haram, immoral sources, even if it, you know, involves destroying other people's lives. This is number one. Number two, the shaitan, he exploits our love of money by whispering to us and convincing us to spend that money that we made, whether through halal or haram, spend it in haram. So when you make the money, he tells you make it through haram because you love it so much, you're greedy, you want it even through haram. Now that you have it, he tells you, he convinces you to spend it on haram things, haram avenues. Alhamdulillah, the business is good, right? He comes and he whispers to you. He tells you, you have that extra money, you don't need it. Instead of telling myself, let me donate it. Sometimes our savings account, brothers and sisters, years I don't touch, those dollars are just piling up and piling up and piling up. Why don't I give it sadaqah, brothers and sisters, instead of leaving it in the bank account? So many poor people, they're in need of it. Don't let it just, you know, just sleep in your bank account. Give it fi sabilillah. Give it to poor people. At least do something for your akhirah. This is what will count on the day of judgment. So the shaitan comes to me and he tells me, spend your money on haram things. Like what? One thing I see in communities, Muslim, Shia communities, even religious people, one way they spend their money through haram, you know, is what? Weddings. Almost every wedding, there's probably 5% I would exclude. Almost every wedding you go to today, Muslim, Shia, religious people, but you find music. Music is being played on in the wedding. And I've seen weddings where they bring musicians, Shia people, and they pay him top dollars. All this money is haram. And then there's dancing and whatnot, unfortunately. This is how I start my marriage. Marriage that you want Allah to bless. You start it by disobeying Allah through all this haram, through all this immorality. And then a couple of months down the road, when there are problems, I ask Allah, why? I want to go to the Mawlana, please help us. I complain, Ya Allah, why? When you start your entire marriage with haram, you want Allah to bless that marriage? Of course Allah Azza wa Jal is not going to bless that marriage. Another example you see sometimes in certain communities, people spend, religious people, mu'mineen, they spend money on haram. Husband and wife, they get divorced. This is especially in the Western countries, right? The husband takes the wife to court, or the wife takes the husband to court, right? And she wants to take half the money, the husband doesn't want. And you know who benefits from this? The lawyers. They spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on lawyers. I remember once there was a case where a wife took her husband to court and they were getting divorced. The husband and wife ended up spending $600,000 on lawyers and expenses because it took so long. All this, brothers and sisters, is haram money. When you go and you go to, you know, the non-Muslims, you ask them to help you against your Muslim brother, your Muslim sisters. This is all the work of the shaitan. When he whispers to us, you made the money, spend it on haram. Why? Because you want to feed that greed, you want to feed that ego, you want to feed that arrogance. So this is number two. This is the second way that the shaitan exploits our love for money, and he makes us do haram things with money, spend it on haram. And number three, the third way that the shaitan exploits our love for money is that he convinces us to not pay our religious dues to Allah Azza wa Jal. You start refusing to pay your khumus, you start refusing to pay zakat, you don't want to pay your financial obligations, you don't want to donate, you don't want to give charity. He tries his best to dissuade you. Do not give. You see, when you love money, brothers and sisters, it's not hard to give it for Allah, right? Because you're so attached to it. It's like your own little baby, you're giving it away. So you can't let go of it. And remember, we said the older you get, the greedier you get. The wealthier you get, the stingier you get, subhanAllah. You know, there are studies that have been done that prove wealthier people, they are less generous as a percentage than, you know, the middle class individuals. I remember there was a study done in the US that the study found that on average, wealthy people, millionaires and billionaires, they spend about 1% on average of their income, of their money, of their wealth on charity. Versus middle, you know, class people, they spend up to 3%. So they're giving more. Because the more you have of the dunya, the more you're attached to it. Remember, it's like salt water. The more you have, the more you love it. So when you have money, it's not going to be easy when you love it to give it away fi sabilillah. So what does the shaitan do? When you want to give, when you're asked by your local masjid, when you're asked, brothers and sisters, the Singapore Jama'at, we need money, we need your kind contributions and donations so that we can make these programs possible. When you want to donate, the shaitan comes to you when you want to help a cause of Allah Azza wa Jalla. You know what he does? He begins to whisper in your ears. He puts all these ideas in your ears, in your mind. He tries to give you excuses so that you don't give. He tries to change your mind. You know what? But what if I get laid off? What if I lose my job? Yeah, I want to give $1,000, but I don't know. You know, there's this pandemic and I don't know what's going to happen. Maybe I need this money. I need it for later. What if there's an emergency? You know, and then you start thinking about all the bills. SubhanAllah, all of a sudden, all the bills, they pop in your mind. I have my gas bill. I have my electric bill. I have my water bill. I have my rent to pay. I have my mortgage to pay. I have my kids' schools. I have this. I have this. All of a sudden, you become a certified consultant. You remember all the bills. This is the shaitan. This is no coincidence, brothers and sisters. All those thoughts are put in my head by the shaitan. Why? Because he wants to scare you. He wants to prevent you. He wants to dissuade you. These are the whispers of the shaitan. Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned this in the Quran. This is no secret. He has exposed the shaitan in the Quran, but we don't read the Quran. We don't contemplate upon the Quran. Allah says in the Holy Quran, الشَّيْطَانُ يَعِدُكُمُ الْفَقْرِ. The shaitan, Satan threaten you. He threatens you. He scares you with poverty. When you want to give, be careful. If you give now, you will be in need later. Don't make this mistake. You need this later. Maybe you'll be laid off. Maybe you'll lose your job. Maybe. He threatens you. He scares you. If you give, you're going to be in need later. While Allah Azza wa Jal, brothers and sisters, is so generous, never will He make you in need because you helped His causes. I mean, imagine what kind of merciful Lord, generous Lord, I help His causes. Because I helped His causes, I become poor. Yes, I could become in need. I could lose, you know, money for other reasons. But because I took $5,000, $10,000, and I generously gave to my masjid, and then I will be in need of that money. Allah will make me in need of that money that I gave for Him. Never. Allah is so generous. Not only will He not make you in need because you gave, He will give you back 100-fold, 1,000-fold, brothers and sisters. This is what He says in the Holy Quran. Allah says, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. And whoever fears Allah, is conscience aware of Allah, has taqwa. Remember, we spoke about taqwa. Whoever has taqwa and fears Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will find a way out for him and give him rizq. Remember, we spoke about rizq. Rizq is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah will give him rizq in a way he never thought possible. In a way he never thought that, you know, there are sources that you expect to receive rizq from. There are sources that you never expect. Allah Azza wa Jal will give you in a way in which you never imagined was possible. Allah says in the Holy Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Whoever has taqwa, fears Allah, protects himself from haram. Taqwa, protection from haram, fear Allah, his conscience and aware of Allah. يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. And Allah will give you rizq and sustenance through ways you never thought were possible, beyond your imagination. Allah Azza wa Jal. When you fear Allah, Allah Azza wa Jal will give you that rizq in a way you never thought this was possible. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, you know, sometimes there are sources that you expect to receive money from. Sometimes sources you never expected, all of a sudden you receive from this source that you never expected. Allah Azza wa Jal makes that possible when you have taqwa, you fear Him, you follow Him, you obey Him. So the shaitan, he tries to make me fear the fact that if I give, I will lose. But Allah says, do not listen to the shaitan. This is the threats of the shaitan. Listen to me. I am telling you, don't worry about it. I will take care of you. There is a scholar who once told me the story. He says, someone called me and he asked for an appointment. He said, tomorrow I want to come and I want to meet you. So when he came the next day, this man, he said, Sayyid, I'm here to pay my khums. I'm here to pay my khums. Khums is 20% of surplus. He says, Sayyid, I have $5 million in my bank account. So my khums is 1 million. You think it's easy to pay 1 million? Wallahi, it is not. The more we have of the dunya, the more we love it, we're attached to it. He says, Sayyidna, I'm here to pay my money, but after I called you, you don't know what happened to me. The shaitan, the thoughts. I kept on thinking and thinking and thinking, should I give, should I not give? Should I change my mind? What if I'm in need of this money? I could use this money to expand my business, this. He says, for the entire night, the shaitan was whispering. I could not sleep, he says. How am I going to give that money tomorrow? And then he says, I have to. It's a battle. And then I would say, no, no, Allah will give. And then once again, the shaitan. He says it was a battle the entire night until finally I overcame the shaitan. I came, requires courage. He says, I came and I'm giving this fi sabilillah. But know that it's not easy. Yes, brothers and sisters, it's not easy. It's not easy when you're in love, when you're attached to something. It's not easy to give it. It's not easy to let go, to be separated from it. And this is exactly what the Prophet tells us. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in one hadith, he quotes Iblis. You know, Iblis, sometimes he gives us advice. It's useful advice. Yes, sometimes it's false, fake advice that he gave Adam when he told him, eat from the tree and you'll be immortal. Sometimes it's true, genuine advice. The Prophet quotes Iblis. Iblis, he told who? He told Prophet Musa. He told Prophet Musa, إِذَا هَمَمْتَ بِصَدَقَةٍ فَمْضِهَا. You want a word of advice from me? If you ever wanted to give a sadaqah fi sabilillah, then do it right away. Do not waste a single second. Do not wait. Do not say, I'll think about it tomorrow. Never do this. Why? He gives the reason. He says, وَإِذَا هَمَّ الْعَبْدُ بِصَدَقَةٍ كُنْتُ صَاحِبَهُ دُونَ أَصْحَابِ حَتَّى أَحُولَ بَيْنَهُ. He says, because when you say, let me think about it, I will quickly come to you. I will send my minions and I will come and I will use all my power and might nonstop. I'll try to dissuade you, to convince you not to. So he says, if you want to give sadaqah, do it right away so that I don't have time to come and convince you to not give it, to dissuade you from giving. Do it right away. Close the door for the shaitan. Don't allow the shaitan to come. Once you say, let me think about it, I'll see when I go home, let me check. The shaitan is going to come. Trust me, you're not going to give. Because the shaitan is going to come. He says, I'll be your best friend. I'll stick to you. I'll stay with you until I am sure you don't give. All the excuses will come. Your wife will come nag to you. Let's go to a vacation. We need this. We need that. We have to, you know, remodel the house. We have to get a new car. The husband will nag on the wife. The children will come nagging. I'll begin to think my mortgage, my tax, my this, my that. Thousand thoughts come. Why? Because you want to. The shaitan wants to dissuade you from giving. You know, they say that once a man, he went to a fundraising dinner. So he was asked to donate generously. And then the scholar said, if you don't, the shaitan will come to you and he will dissuade you. So the man, he said, I'll think about it. When I go home, I'll see how much I'll give. When he went home, he wanted to write a check. His wife said, what are you doing? I'm writing a check. She said, come on, there's other priorities we have. You promised me this ring. You promised me this necklace. You promised me this trip. She kept on complaining, so he didn't give. So a couple of days later, he saw that same scholar. He told him, brother, you never gave fi sabilillah. He says, yeah, what can you do? Inshallah, next year. So the scholar told him, I bet the shaitan came to you. Yes, and he dissuaded you. So he thought for a second. He said, I don't know about the shaitan. I think the mother of the shaitan was sent to me. You know, sometimes, yes, unfortunately, we are dissuaded by human beings. Sometimes the husband will dissuade. I've heard certain stories. Sisters, they come to me. She's a woman. She works. The wife works, it's her money, but the husband, wants to tell her what to do. This is haram. This is her money. You have no power. You have no authority over your wife's money. If she is the one that is working and she's making the money, he tells her, don't give to this cause. Don't give to that cause. Help in the bills. The wife doesn't have to help in the bills. It is all the responsibility of the husband. So the point is, brothers and sisters, do not leave an opening for the shaitan. When you want to give, do it now. Don't say later. Because when you say later, the shaitan will come. You're creating an avenue and a way for the shaitan to sneak in and to exploit you. So this is what the love of money does to us, brothers and sisters. It can lead us to so many violations, so many crimes, so many haram. Because sometimes the greed will be so powerful that I will do anything. I will be willing to do anything just to receive that money. Sometimes even killing a wali of awliya Allah, even killing a imam, will become okay for me, permissible, just to see it, just so that I can feed that greed inside me. Even if it means killing the grandson of Hussein, fine, so that I feed my greed. Umar ibn Sa'd, the commander of the army of Yazid, why did he go forward with killing Imam Hussein? You don't think he knew that Imam Hussein was the grandson of the Prophet? He knew it! But because he had greed for the dunya. He says it in a poem. He says, أَأَتْرُكُ مُلْكَ الرَّيِّ وَالرَّيُّ مُنْيَتِي أَمْ أَرْجِعُ مَأْثُومًا بِقَتْلِ حُسَيْنِي. He says, look, I have two thoughts in my head. One is that Yazid ibn Ziyad promised me if I go kill Hussein, he will make me the governor of Ray, present day Tehran, Tehran in Iran. So he says, should I leave Mulk al-Ray? The greed, I can't leave. The fact that I love being the governor of Ray. Am arji'u ma'thuman biqatli Hussein? But on the other hand, this is Hussein, the grandson of Rasulullah. How can I kill him? What should I do? Should I kill Hussein? I will receive the governorship of Ray. But at the same time, this is a huge sin. What do I do? In the end, his greed was more powerful than his taqwa. It was more powerful than anything inside him. His conscience, his fitrah, his taqwa, his fear of Allah Azza wa Jal. So his greed for the dunya, for money, for power, it led him to kill Abu Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. This is what greed does to us, brothers and sisters. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. It is the night of Ashura. I want you to imagine what happened, what the family of Rasulullah went through, brothers and sisters. It's the night of Ashura. Bibi Zainab alayha salam is spending her final hours with her brother Husayn, with her brother Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. She is protected. No one can come close to Zainab on a night like this, the night of Ashura. But tomorrow, only in a few hours, she will be left all alone between the widows and the orphans. You think Bibi Zainab slept on a night like this? She cannot sleep thinking, I will lose Hussein, I will lose Abbas and be all alone between the enemies. It was the night of Ashura. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was protecting the tent, guarding the tent at night. All of a sudden he sees movement from the tent of the woman. He quickly goes thinking it's an enemy. All of a sudden he realizes it's a sister, Zainab. My dear sister Zainab, why are you awake at this late time? It's dangerous, go sleep. She tells him, Abbas, how can I sleep knowing you will be killed tomorrow? Hussein will be killed. La ilaha illallah. And then Zainab tells Abbas, my dear brother Abbas, I want to tell you a story. And she tells him the story of how Imam Ali alayhi salam married Ummul Baneen, the mother of Al-Abbas. She tells him, he only married your mother so that he would have a brave child. Why does he want a brave child? This is after Fatima al-Zahra. Because he wanted a child that was brave to protect his son Hussein on the day of Kar, on the day of Ashura. Allahu Akbar. 30, 40 years before Ashura, Imam Ali is planning. He wants Hussein to have that right hand, that man, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam. So after she tells him the story, she tells him, please, Ya Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, please, I want you to defend Hussein on the day of Ashura tomorrow. Please don't have any shortcomings. Make sure you protect him as long as you are alive. He tells her, he holds his sword and he tells her, أَتُشَجِّعِينَنِي وَأَنَا بْنُ عَلِيٍّ. Zainab, you don't need to encourage me. I am the son of Ali. Don't worry. وَاللَّهِ لَأَنْعُمَنَّكِ عَيْنَا. Wallahi, tomorrow I will make you proud, my dear sister Zainab. What a night this was. Bibi Zainab alayha salam was spending her last moments with her family, with Hussein, with Abbas alayhi salam. I want to read you a poem. It shows us how Zainab felt, as if she speaks to the night. She does not want this night, the night of Ashura, to finish, because what's waiting is Ashura. What's waiting is the maqtal of Hussein. What's waiting is Imam Hussein and Abbas being killed, butchered, slaughtered in front of her eyes. So it's as if Zainab speaks to the night. Oh night, prolong your hours. Zainab speaks to the night. She wants the night to be longer. She doesn't want it to be a 7-8 hour night. She wants it to be a much longer night. So she speaks to the night. Oh night, prolong your hours. Oh night, carry your sorrows. Tonight is Zainab's last night. It's the last night she's surrounded by Hussein and Abbas. Tonight, prepare for the fight. Tomorrow's Hussein's last fight. Tomorrow's the day of might. She speaks to the night of Ashura. Oh night, have mercy on my heart. Zainab tells the night, have mercy, please do not leave. Oh night, my hopes have been lost. Tonight, weep Zainab and sigh. Tonight, mourn Hussein and cry. Zainab, brace for tragedy. Zainab, brace for agony. Zainab, brace for agony. Tonight is Zainab's last night. Tonight, prepare for the fight. Brothers and sisters, this is the night of Ashura. The greatest calamity will take place in a few hours. If you haven't shed any tears so far for Hussein, for the masa'ib of Abi Abdullah, this is the time to shed tears for Hussein. This is the time to shed tears for the masa'ib of Hussein. Ibn Shabib is told by Imam al-Ridha. He tells his companion Ibn Shabib, if you cry for my grandfather Hussein, Allah will forgive you of your sins. Shed tears for your master, for the mazloom, for the gharib, for the gharib, for the shaheed, for Hussein. As-salamu ala al-Hussein wa ala Ali ibn الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. يا الله نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم العز الأجل الأكرم يا الله 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 يا الله. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج. Oh Allah, we ask you to give us the ability and the tawfiq that we can continue and follow in the footsteps of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. Grant us, Ya Allah, the ziyarah of Hussein in this dunya, as shafa'ah in the next life. Grant anyone that is sick full shafa'ah. Anyone that is haja, Ya Allah, grant them their hajat. Accept our a'mal, forgive us of our sins, And let us remember the mu'mineen and mu'minat that have departed us by reciting Surah Al-Fatiha after a loud salawat for Muhammad and Al-Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.